How cool is that? You're looking at the brand new, actually still on pre-order, FLSUN V400. A Delta printer capable of speeds of up to, well, 400, as the name suggests. That's millimeters per second, obviously. It is fast. Let's go. The V400 is a spiritual and literal successor to the FLSUN SR, which I reviewed back in April, at which time I mentioned that FLSUN had mentioned that there was a new model coming. This insanely fast Delta printer releases in somewhere around September if you've pre-ordered, and somewhere around October onwards if you don't. I'm not using the words lightly, by the way. Its speed claims are literally double those of the SR. Double. The first thing that might raise an eyebrow on this machine is that it runs KLIPPER. To get you up to speed, KLIPPER is a relatively new printer control system that, unlike Marlin, doesn't just run on the main board of the printer itself. It does run on the main board itself, but it also needs a host processor like a Raspberry Pi or something else more powerful to do the non-trivial maths behind the kinematics of moving the stepper motors, and those are especially non-trivial in a Delta printer like this. In the case of this printer, KLIPPER is implemented via the board, which is a genuine, I think, Robin Nano 2, which is actually quite cool. And the host is the bespoke speeder pad, which is pretty high spec for a control panel. It's got 1 gig of DDR RAM. It's running Ubuntu ARM Linux. It looks like it's a Pi build, and it looks like it's mainsail OS. It's a 7-inch capacitive touchscreen, and it is nice. The processor speed is 1.6 GHz if you're wondering, and it has 4 cores, so it's sort of Pi-ish. It's self-powered by the printer too, via some cables that run out of the base. We've got a lot to get through, so I'll just show you the filament path, which is something I also liked on the SR. It's very similar here. The filament is kept on top of the machine, as in the reel, and it's routed straight through with PTFE tube and into the filament detector and then down into the direct drive head, which I haven't even mentioned yet. Yes, this is, unbelievably, a direct drive Delta printer. Let's talk about that. The effector, that's the bit with the hot end on, is a very miniaturized extruder and hot end combo. They've managed to fit in a tiny BMG-style dual-gear direct drive extruder with a round motor, which I did ask, it's capable of 2 amps apparently, although it does get quite warm on the 0.9 amps it runs on. It didn't cause any issues other than making me say, ooh, that's quite warm. It's still well within spec. I think it was running around 45 degrees C, which is nothing for steppers, so maybe it can do 2 amps. Because we're running KLIPPER, of course, we can see what everything is set to, even down to stepper currents, and the motion steppers are quite chunky in this machine, just as they were on the SR. I think they might even be the same size. So they're probably not even maxed out at 1.7 amps, and they look to be running in fully silent mode. Because the machine is pre-built with KLIPPER, all the hard work has been done for you, so the touchscreen is already fully working and has macros for things that you need too, like turning the lights on and off, and recording time lapses. And mainsail is set up and working out of the box. Once you connect the Wi-Fi, you can log straight in on the correct IP address, which you can get from the screen, and then on a web browser, you can open the mainsail interface, which is really cool. It's worth stressing that if you think you're not sure whether you will be able to use KLIPPER, or if you think it might be too hard for you, there is absolutely nothing to worry about here. It's really user-friendly. You need zero knowledge of KLIPPER's existence even to use this printer. We should probably talk about the nozzle, but it's honestly a bit of a mystery at this stage. Feel free to discuss it in the comments. Extreme Vars Mode 3, maybe? What's really good to see on this printer though is a 300 degrees Celsius temperature limit on the hot end and a bimetal heat break. This means you can confidently print PETG as a matter of routine, and you can maybe experiment with higher temperature stuff too. I tested PETG and I had no real problems at all, except I guess maybe you have to dial the speed down a bit. I found that. It might just have been the PETG I was using, but time will tell. The printer shows a lot of promise for TPU and other flexible filaments, and this did really show in my tests. The stringing test came out really well, and the overhangs are really neat too, even the steep ones. The actual finish quality is outstanding. I can't explain how happy I am to be able to print TPU on a Delta printer. There is one footnote to this, of course. There is a speed limit on TPU, and it's actually quite low. I've shared a profile already on my website for TPU on this printer for Cura 5, so bookmark that if you decide to get this printer. Of course, PLA prints fine too, and PLA is what I use to do most of the testing around the faster speeds, and watching the machine print fast is quite addictive. Something is missing though, hang on. That works so much better than it does on a bed slinger. Anyway, acceleration is set to 8,000 with max speed at 400. We already knew that. And I'm not really that familiar with what square corner velocity means, but it's set to 5. Let me know in the comments if that's high or not. It seems like the machine certainly intends to go fast, and it does indeed go fast. I will test the speed, though, in another video. I have an idea on how to do that. Bed leveling is the same as it was on the SR, with a static bed and a detachable probe. This worked really well on the SR. In fact, I only ever had to run it once in several months of printing, so I expect it will work well on this printer too, and so far I've not had to re-level at all here either. I was given files for Cura 5 with instructions on how to install them. I would assume that FLSUN intend to have machines added to Cura by the time they release, but if not, this is not a particularly tricky process, and it adds exactly one machine profile called normal. It's really not very normal. I've made a few other profiles which I will share in due course. The standard normal one provided is pretty much full speed for the printer, which is quite excessive for a lot of users. Somehow it still manages to retain excellent quality though. The calibration cube that I did on this normal profile came out really well, and my own calibration piece really only broke down on the top where it's trying to bridge too fast, I think. I think there's quite a lot of situations where you're not going to be running this printer at anywhere near full speed, but it's there if you need it. It's remarkable that the quality is this good at these speeds though. This is a testament to Clipper, I think, as well as the build quality of the machine. By the way, to make these thumbnails appear on the screen, there are two ways of doing it, I think, but the easiest one is to install the Moonraker connection plugin in Cura, and this allows you to upload prints with a single click. You use a UFP format, I think it's called, which I haven't really looked into yet. And this leads me to the point of making a sum up and conclusion, I guess. There's some other points I didn't have time to go into because there's so much new on this machine and I don't want this to be a long, boring video. The hot end has a really bright light on it. It's actually three white LED strips, as you saw. You don't need to light the room while you're printing. The bed is PEI, which is really good, and it's the decent textured PEI too, which I think is made by Energetic. Size-wise, it is the same height as the SR, but it is wider, so if you're replacing the SR with this printer, you will need a bigger space to put it. The bed is also larger in diameter as well. I think that's about it for features. I spoke to FLSUN about two matters that I had questions about. Firstly, the weird nozzles will be available to buy, and they will be in different sizes. This will happen in due course. By the way, I also did try a normal volcano nozzle, and it works fine. Secondly, I was assured that a Linux image for the Clipper installation on the tablet screen thing will be available in case you corrupt it, which is one of the concerns. That should be available again in due course. For a full disclosure of my experience, I also want to mention that during testing, I did have one blockage. It was quite a bad one. I had to take the nozzle out and kind of figure out what was going on. I didn't figure out what was going on. I don't really want to make a thing of it because I didn't find the cause, and it didn't repeat during 50 plus hours of printing. So it could have been anything. So let's talk about the good things about this printer. Well, it's really well built, even more so than the SR, and the SR was well built. Everything about this printer is spot on as far as I'm concerned for the price. The pre-order price at the time of review is between $800 and $999, which is not cheap, of course, but look at it. You get what you pay for, enough said. Would I buy it? Yes, I would, but take that as you will. I've always had a fascination with Delta printers. My first printer was a Delta. Bad points about this printer? I'm really struggling on this one. I think cooling often can't keep up with the print speed and flow rate. Not surprising, really, but it can catch you out. I've had some fully soft completed vase mode prints that I've bent while taking off the bed because they're just completely hot still. I guess the mystery blockage I had remains a mystery. I guess it's not that quiet at the top speeds either, and it does shake the table a lot, and it does make some kind of banging noises, but what do you expect at those speeds? Find me a printer that doesn't do that at 400 millimeters per second. Other than that, I have got nothing. FLSUN have even been good with replacement parts on the SR. You could buy them all in their shop, even in the UK. So I don't even have any concerns there. I even feel like the Clipper implementation, even though it looks bespoke on the face of it, actually most of it is off-the-shelf parts. So The machine is actually pretty moddable, in my opinion. That will become evident over time as people do that. A lot of people modded the SR. So there you go. What do you think about this machine? Are you impressed? Let me know in the comments, and I will see you next time. Thank you for watching.